All right, I think we can go ahead and get started. So let's do that. Hopefully everybody can hear me okay. Looks like we've got a good number of people so far this morning, so that's really awesome. For those of you that are new, my name's Alex. I will be conducting the webinar just like I do each and every week. For those of you that are returning, thanks for coming back. Hopefully we will cover some new things for you today. Just to give everyone an idea of how everything works, generally we do a question and answer type of session where you can utilize the chat feature and ask questions about making changes and edits to your website, and I do my very best to answer those for you. Today's going to be a little bit different. I'm going to go over some things first before we open it up to the question and answer session. I don't want to spend a lot of time on what we're going to cover, so then we can get into the question section. So go ahead and do that. So if you would hold off on your questions until I'm ready, that will help out a little bit. So the first thing that I want to go over today is the Acuity online scheduling application. I believe everybody should have received an email with a little bit of information about how that can be added to your website, and how by upgrading your website from the free starter kit, how you would have access to that. So I just kind of wanted to cover this a little bit to kind of give you some information about what the Acuity application can do and how you can apply it to your website. And once we cover that, then we'll jump into the question and answer portion. Okay, so everybody should have received an email notification kind of talking about this new Acuity application that can be applied to your website. Terry actually mentioned that he already has, or he or she, I'm sorry, I'm not sure, has an Acuity account and how it can actually be working with the website. So we're going to cover that just a little bit. Once you actually decide to upgrade your account, when you go into the edit window, you'll actually see down here on the bottom, you'll see an Acuity application element, just like we have for the rest of the elements, such as the IIN forms and everything like that. What Acuity is, it's an online scheduling application. They actually have their own website. Where you can go there and you can kind of see what they do. Basically, what allows potential clients to do is schedule an appointment with you directly from your website. So they don't have to call, email you, or anything like that. And they can just literally select a time where you're available and select their purchase or schedule an appointment, pay for it right then and there, all of that very easily from your website. So it's a nice opportunity to kind of streamline the whole scheduling process for you. So generally what you would do first is you would go to Acuity.com or AcutiyScheduling.com, and I'll throw this URL into the chat window for everyone. There's also in the support portal of the website, there is actually, in the What's New section, there is a guide page that goes over, there's an introductory video that kind of covers the exact same thing that we're going to cover briefly here. I'll throw that in the support in the chat window as well. That'll give you a little bit more information on the process and how it works. So once we do that, so once you actually need to create an Acuity account first, which is completely free to do. So you would create your Acuity account, and within your account you actually have the ability to set up your appointments, whatever you would like to have, whether it's, you know, 30-minute appointments, initial consultations, anything to that degree. You can set it up and customize it however you want within your actual account. Then to actually integrate it within your website, you would simply link the two of them together. And you would do that in the dashboard. Once you go through the process of upgrading your account, you'll have access to the Acuity application. You'll see it in the application section of your dashboard, just like you will with the IIN forms in the recipe section. And like I mentioned previously, you'll actually see it when you go into the edit window. You'll see the Acuity application element down here in the lower left corner. So once you have it available in your application section, you would just click on it, and you'll see this instruction say, to successfully link your account, click here to log in. And what it'll do is you will just simply click here and you would log in with your Acuity information, your username and your password, and just click allow access. And all it does is then simply links your website to your Acuity account. You'll get this notification here to let you know everything is linked. Once you have it linked up, then you can easily place that element onto your website. You just go into the extra Acuity or the edit window, take the element, drag it onto your website. Just like any of the other elements, you can place it wherever you would like on the page. And if you haven't linked your account, you'll get a notification saying that you need to log into your Acuity account and link that process. Otherwise, you're all good. Once you've done it in your dashboard, you're all set and ready to go. Then you can simply click on Save Changes, and it's going to reflect your Acuity window. So what'll happen is whenever a visitor comes to, a potential client will come to your site, they will see essentially your calendar available on the website, wherever you've placed it. Depending on how you've set it up within your Acuity account, they'll have the drop-down menu where they can select what type of appointment they would like to schedule with you. For example, if I wanted to schedule an aromatherapy one, I can click on it, and the dates that are highlighted in bold indicate the dates that I've set up where I have availability for those appointments. So within your Acuity account, you have the ability to say what days and what times you're available for certain appointments. So let's say I want to schedule one for tomorrow, which is Friday the 13th. So I can click on that day, and I can see all the available times that are listed. And let's say I want to do 2:30 p.m. Now, if I want it to be a recurring appointment, I can click on that. But if I want the one-time appointment, I can simply just click Continue. And then I fill out my information. Enter in my first name. And then complete my appointment. And depending on how you have it set up, you can require payment right away or you can require payment a little bit later. Then as the user confirms the appointment, they'll be taken to this screen where they can see this and say, okay, this is my appointment information. I can add it to any of my specific calendars that I have. And I can also save my information by creating an account. And it's that simple. If it's a recurring thing, it saves all the client's information so they can easily schedule appointments over and over again. So that's essentially how the Acuity application works in conjunction with your website. Now, Terry asked a little bit earlier as far as he has four different calendars within your Acuity account. Does that mean that you have four different types of appointments, Terry? Okay. So I'm assuming it would be the same thing where they would have in the dropdown, it would show the four different, all the different types of appointments that you would have. So like for this one, there's two different appointments. So if you have four, it would show you all four. Yep. I'm pretty sure that's how it works. So you should be able to do that. Now, as I said, everybody should have received an email with information on how to upgrade their package. You can also if you're interested, if you haven't found that email, then you could actually fill out this form on the information update request. And then it'll actually automatically send you that very same email with the information. So you have separate calendars, each with separate appointment types. That's interesting. I'm not sure how that would work, Terry. Just because when we actually use the element on the website, there isn't anything specific as far as that goes. It literally will just pull the information. So I'm not sure how that would work if you have separate calendars like that. I'm not really sure how that would work. I can try to find out some more information for it And if I can find out some more information, I will actually add it to the Acuity document or document that we have in the portal for you. But otherwise, I'm not really sure how that would work. But like I said, in the portal, there's an actual tutorial video that kind of walks through the whole process a little bit. Good introduction on how it works. If you're interested, I recommend checking that out. And if you haven't received the email, or if you lost the email or deleted it, you can always fill out the upgrade request to receive that email again. Yeah, I'm not sure, Terry. I really don't know a whole lot about multiple calendars with it. I don't see why it wouldn't work. I mean, it's designed to be very easy and flexible with it, but that's a unique setup that you have. So I'm just not overly familiar with what can be done with that. Is there any additional questions on Acuity or anything like that before we jump into the standard question and answer portion? Time trade might work the same way. The difference with Acuity is we actually have an element that makes it very easy to drag and place in. Time trade could very well work. You'd have to check within your time trade account. Most likely it would be something where you could add your time trade calendar to your account by using the HTML tool. You would probably be able to create some sort of HTML widget within your time trade account that would make it very easy to implement into your website. But that's something that you'd have to check within your time trade account for. I'm Donna asking the support Facebook page. That is great. I was actually going to mention this. There is a group that was started by health coaches a while back. It's just a Facebook group where people actually come in and ask questions on how to make different edits. There was a thread that was started last week where people are sharing their different websites so everybody can go through and see examples of other health coaches' websites. It's a good resource to kind of get information and so on from your fellow health coaches. It's completely separate from Live Edit. It's started and run by fellow health coaches. I try to chime in when there's questions from time to time. I'll try to provide answers and so on. So it's a good resource to use. I definitely recommend checking it out. I'll post the link in the chat window for everyone. So if that's something that you're interested in, I definitely recommend checking that out. All right, so I think we can go ahead and get started with the question and answer portion. We got a couple of questions that have come in already, so go ahead and get started with that. If at any time I'm going too fast or you need me to repeat myself, feel free to let me know. I know that there was a comment a little bit earlier about someone who needed to leave a little bit early from Sonali. We do the webinars every week, so you can join in on a weekly basis. If there's anything that you miss, the webinar is being recorded, and it will be posted to the support portal within 24 hours, so you can always go back and rewatch them. We've been going through and actually categorizing them a little bit, so it makes it a little bit easier for you to find the information. On the YouTube page, it'll actually have little links to all the different topics. So you'll be able to see that information. But as far as any questions that don't get answered before you have to hop off, you could email our support team if you want. Also, the Facebook page is a great resource to ask those questions. A lot of times, fellow health coaches will have those answers for you. I know, like I said, I try to chime in from time to time to be able to help out as well. So. Yes, you can integrate various social medias. Within the support portal, there's actually a section on doing that very same thing. So I recommend checking out those guide pages. I'll post the link in the chat window for you. So Marina asks, can you please send us the YouTube link for previous webinars? All of that information is found within the support portal. You get to the support portal by once you're logged into your website, go over to the profile section and click help. It'll open the support portal in a new window. The first section right here on the right-hand side is our webinar video gallery. It has links to every webinar that we've done and the videos that you can have there. So, all right, I've got a lot of good questions, so I want to be able to get started with them. So if I haven't gotten to your question, just be patient. I will do my best to make sure that I get through each and every one of them. So, so it looks like we have some good questions that come in. Snowy asks, what kind of analytics does the Live Edit platform provide? Am I able to see where my clients are coming from and where I'm losing clients? The only way to see that information is to link your account with a Google Analytics account. We don't have any information provided within the website that allows you to track who's seeing your website from where and how often it's being visited. You'd have to have some sort of outside account, like a Google Analytics account, to link up a Google Analytics account with your website. Google Analytics actually has a lot of documentation on how to do that, and then it's actually something that you need to send us a code, an HTML code that we add to the website. It's a very simple process, takes a few minutes, so that's definitely something that the support team can help you with, but there's nothing that we provide within the website to do that. Tula asks, each new page has a preset content to drag and drop. I find it difficult to work with this. The platform I'm used to is a blank page, and it's much easier to place items exactly where you want them. How can we delete all preset stuff to have a blank page? Now, Tula, I'm going to assume you're talking about, and I'll go to an inside page. I presume you're talking about clearing all of this stuff and just starting from scratch. Is that right? If you want to have a completely, not the content, you can't get rid of the content areas. All of these container areas, those are there. That's the areas where you can add content to the page. You won't be able to delete any of those instances. But if you want to create a brand new page, for example, if we go into our pages section and click add item, and we select a page and give it a title and select a place where we want it to go, and when we create a new page, it's completely blank, like this. There's no content on it. Now, all of the fields that are there are options for adding content. We don't have to use any of them. You can use one if you want to. If you want to use several of them, you can. But those are the only options that you have as far as where content can go. Does that make sense, Twilla? What aspect of it do you find difficult? That's the beauty of it. You can place items wherever you want. And once you place items, you have the ability to move them. Let me go to a page that actually has content. So for example, if I don't like the way that this page is set up, I can move it. I can just drag this picture and move it someplace else. I can drag this text and move it someplace else. Same with this text. Any space that you're not using simply doesn't show up. So for example, I'm not using any of these boxes between those images, between this content. So I can simply close out of edit mode and they don't appear. the reason that all these different content areas exist, because it gives you different options on how you want to rearrange the stuff on your page. A lot of it will come down to kind of some trial and error to figure out where you want that content to go, but that's the flexibility of having those numerous content areas available. I understand that you're the frustration with it, but I'm not. It would depend on how you want to lay out your website, Twilla. As far as the spaces that you don't want them and how you're utilizing the content areas. It's hard to explain and hard to answer the question. Let me give it some thought, and let's move on to some of these other questions before we start getting super far behind, because I know you actually asked some other questions too, so let's see if we can answer some of those, and then we can jump back into that. Okay. Jeff asks, how do I change the color of the background behind a personal photo on the homepage? And how do I redirect all of my pins on Pinterest that were pinned from my old site to our new website? All right, the first thing that I'll answer, Jeff, is how do you change the color of the background behind a personal photo on the homepage? I'm going to presume that you have the Foodie Bonanza templates. You're talking about this person, this picture right here. Is that right, Jeff? You're asking how to change this background picture here? Okay. To change the background picture of this section on the Foodie Bonanza template, you would go into edit mode, and that section is section one right here. So to change that, I would click on the blue notepad icon right here, and it would open this up. Depending if you have a newer template or if you've ordered your site recently or not, sometimes it'll actually show you the image that's here. Let me see if I can give you an example. If you have a more recent site, when you click on that, it'll actually show you the picture that is here, just like this. Some of the older ones won't show you that information, but it's still there. Now, to remove that picture completely, if you don't want a picture there at all, what you would need to do is you could click remove, but it's not going to remove that picture. So you want to be able to type in the word none, and as you type in none, just type in none and hit enter. You don't have to click remove, just type in the word none, and then click somewhere else. You can see that picture is now gone. Now if I want to change the background color, I can go to the color section and I can select my background color and adjust it however I want. If I want to put in a different image, instead of typing in the word none, I just click add background image and select a different image to place. Does that answer that question for you? Yeah, I see that you got kicked off, Jeff. Everything was recorded, so you can always go back and rewatch it. But what you would do is you would go into the edit mode and click on section one of your website and click on the notepad icon there, and then with the image you can either replace it by clicking on the image box and selecting a new image, or to remove that image in the space provided, just type the word none and then click over anywhere on the box, and you'll see in the background that image is gone. And then you can change the color scheme. Now Lisa asked, can we change that blue color behind the photo? That's the actual photo. I can see in my file manager that that's the picture. It's a blue picture. There's no color behind it. That's the actual picture. It's a blue picture. So you don't have the option to change that color of that picture. That's just the way that picture is. Does that make sense? The color of the picture is the picture. Like I said, Jeff, if you want to remove that picture, you can say none. Changing the color won't do anything. Let me show you an example. If I don't change that picture, I still have that picture there. If I try to change the color, it's not going to do anything because there's a picture on top of it. I can't change the color of the picture. This color section is to change the background if I'm not using a picture. But like Julie says, yes, anytime you make any changes, go ahead and refresh your page to make sure. So for example, I want to remove this picture. So I'm going to type in none. And I'm going to change the background to green. Now I'm going to save that. Now if I go to a different page, and then I come back to my home page, everything looks the same, right? If I refresh this, it will change that back. Sometimes your website, your internet browser remembers what your website looked like before you made that change. So you just need to make a refresh. So now if I made this change and I don't like it and I want to go back to that picture, I can actually just remove the word none and save my changes. Now if I refresh my page, and set my background color to nothing, now my background color is white. For the older websites, when you do that, your background picture will automatically show up. For the newer websites, when you go to add your background image, you'll actually see your blue background image in your file manager. So you can actually replace that image. All right, let's see what else we got. The second question you had, Jeff, how do I redirect all the pins on Pinterest that were pinned to my old site to your new website? Unfortunately, there isn't a way to redirect that. The only way to do it was to be add in those same images and add in those same pins on your new website. There isn't any way to automatically redirect that stuff. So, which is kind of a bummer. So anyone that has a pin on their Pinterest board to a link on your old site, that's just simply not going to work once your old site's turned off. So. Sarah asks, regarding this picture, the woman picture, how do you get only the silhouette? That should be in your file manager. In your file manager, you should see two pictures. First is the picture with the woman and an actual background of the website, or a background of wherever she's standing. Also in your file manager, if you scroll through, you will find a listing with her. Oh, and on a homepage. No, on the last page. You will find a listing with her that looks like this. It'll have a dotted background. That's the silhouette picture. That was a picture that was created in Photoshop where whoever created the picture actually went through and cut out that background. So if you want to use that silhouette picture, it should be within your file manager. You'll notice it because it'll have that dotted background with it. You'll also find that picture with the background as well. So, if you want to create your own picture with that kind of thing, yes, Sarah, you would have to use something like Photoshop to do it. Okay, Sally asks, I'm totally new to websites and I'm a technologically challenged 57-year-old. Is there a really simple tutorial to follow? I took a look and tried to do a few things, but I'm totally in the dark. Sally, you are not alone. I promise you that you're not. What I recommend you do when you first get started is in the support portal, we have our different sections. Kind of go through the welcome section, maybe some of the site transfer stuff, and then kind of just go through the application section and read some of the overview things just to kind of get a sense of how things work. The managing your website, this will actually go through how to add text, how to add images, those kind of things. The video tutorial section in the manage your website covers a lot of those things as far as how to edit your site and so on. I recommend that as a very good starting point. It'll kind of give you the basics and help you understand how everything works, and it'll let you kind of develop more questions. You can also check out some of the previous webinars for things like that. The Facebook group is an excellent resource to kind of ask other health coaches, you know, kind of what they did to get started. I'm actually working on a new series of videos that will actually walk you through the process a little bit easier than what we have available right now to make the transition not so overwhelming for you. So, but that's what I recommend doing that. We also do the webinars on a weekly basis, so you can always come back and ask questions when you need to. So I definitely encourage you to join in every week. It's a great resource for that. Like I said, with the Facebook group, I'm always trying to answer questions whenever I have the opportunity as well. So that's a good resource too. Okay. Scott says, when I look at the site on a mobile device, it shows a section of blank screen like a sidebar. Is there a setting to remove it? Scott, it would depend on where you're viewing it. When you look at your website on a mobile device, it's going to kind of display the content areas in order. So if you actually have a big space, something like this, where it's just an open space, that's going to show up on your mobile device. So if you don't like that, you might want to take that into consideration. One of the nice things about your website, it's a responsive website, meaning that if you shrink down your screen, the content will shrink down accordingly. So if you're seeing something on the mobile view that you don't necessarily like, you can shrink down your screen and you can continue to edit in this kind of screen size to kind of make it a little bit easier for you. Now, if you're getting completely lost with it and you're not finding any resolution to solve the issues that you're having, sometimes it can be an issue with your template and kind of how it was set up. So you can always, if you're stuck, you can always submit a ticket to our support team and ask them for help. So there's that option as well. All right, see if some of these other questions that we got. Lisa asked, besides support ticket, can we get one-on-one help? I know that's something that we are talking about doing. I'm not sure if it's something that has been made available just yet, but it is something that we plan on doing in the very near future. So I'll keep you as updated as I can on that information. Otherwise, like I said, the Facebook group is a great resource, and the webinars are a good resource and an opportunity to come in and ask specific questions. Arlene asks, how can I change my password without having to reset it all the time? So once you reset your password, as you all know, you kind of get this system-generated password that can be hard to remember. So once you're logged into your website, you go to your profile, and if you click on Manage Profile, there's a password section. And here's where you can change your password to whatever you want. So you can customize it to something that you're going to remember and so on. So I definitely recommend doing that. Now, if you forget your password and you actually go through the process of clicking the forget password link, you're going to get an email with a new system generated password. So that's going to happen every single time. So I definitely recommend coming in and changing your password to something that you're going to remember. It makes it a lot easier. All right, Marina asked, I asked at the beginning of this webinar how I can create a sales page or link up lead pages with LiveEdit to create one. I'm not sure what lead pages is. Is that an outside source, Marina? Okay. I'm not familiar with lead pages, so I'm not sure if that's something that can be linked up directly to your website. I can look into it, and if it is something that we can do, what I can do is I can make a new guide, just like we have with some of the other things. I can make a guide page that'll walk you through the process. So I can check into that as far as lead pages specifically. I'll just make a note here. Other than that, you can create pages on your website to do whatever you'd like them to do. So if you wanted to create a sales page on your website, you could certainly do that. And I know that we had another question earlier about how to actually create new pages. So I'm going to go ahead and cover that really quickly. I just want to make sure that that's the same question that was asked before I jump into that. I think Daryl kind of asked the same thing regarding how to add new things. Okay, so I'm going to go over the process and how to create a new page. With your website, you have a number of pages that came with your website. Some of them you might use, some of them you might not. They're just there as starting points for you. You can certainly do whatever you want with your website. It's your website, and it's going to reflect your business. So it's completely separate in that sense. So to get started, what we're going to do is all of this stuff is going to be handled in the Pages section. So we're going to be clicking on the Pages icon, and that will open up our Pages menu. And in our Pages menu, if you scroll down, you'll see all these tabs that are created. Let me go into this one. This is the tabs that came with your website and so on. Now, within your free starter package, you have a total of 15 pages that you have access to. Now, each one of these tabs represents either a page, a link, or a service. The ones that count as actual pages are the tabs that have these little icons here, just like we have on the revisit form. They look like notebook page type things. That's going to indicate a page. So you actually have the ability to create 15 of those. Now, to find out very easily how many pages you've used, what you can do is you can click on your dashboard icon, and you can click on the account info section, which is the first option on the left. And in the second tab that says your current package, it'll tell you how many pages you've used and how many you have available. For the most part, I think you're going to have 15. I don't remember how many are used right off the bat. Now, when you upgrade your package, when you upgrade your package, you'll be able to add in more pages. But for the free starter package, you only have 15. Now, once you're in the Pages section, you will see all these different pages. You have the ability to edit, add, or delete any of those different things. So, for example, we have three pages that are dedicated to the IIN forms. We have the revisit form and the men's health form and the women's health form. Now, if those are pages that you're not going to use, you have zero interest in using them at all, then you don't need to have them. You can use them for something else, or you can just simply delete them. Now, if you want to delete them, for example, if I wanted to get rid of the men's health form because I'm not going to use it, I can click on this tab. And I can either click the delete button here on the lower left. And if I click delete, you're going to get this little notification saying, are you sure you want to do that? And you want to be sure you want to do that, because once you delete it, it's gone. It's no longer there. So we can delete that. Or we can just use it for something else. I can go through and I can click view to go to that page. And I can see that there's my health history form. Well, if I don't want to use this page for my health history form, I can just delete the content on it. I can click on my form and say, I'm not going to use it. Delete it. I'm not going to use this picture. So I'm going to delete it. I'm not going to use this little window here of text. So I'm going to delete it. And now for this section here, I want my page to be something else. So I want to be a sales form or sales page. So I can just edit this text to say whatever I want. And then I can use this page for whatever it is that I want it to use. Now, if that's the case, if I'm just going to reuse this page for something else, you can see up here in the title section, it's still called Men's Health. So what I would do is I would go back into my Pages section and find that same tab and click on it, and I could just change the name. And if I change the name, I want to make sure to change my page URL too. Now, if you have a title for your page that's more than one word, for the URL, you want to make sure that it's separated by a dash. No spaces, but a dash. You'll see if you try to do it wrong, you'll get this little X notification saying that it's not going to work. You can leave it as one word if you want, but it works better and it looks better if you have it separated by a dash like that. And then you just click update. And now I can see that I've changed the name of that page. So under my little drop down here, it's been sales. I don't know why that keeps happening, but it does. And it's very random and it's annoying. And I apologize for the delay. So let me get back to what we were covering. So if I wanted to create a brand new page, I would do that also in my pages section by clicking add item. And I can name my page whatever I want. And I can also have it go wherever I want. Generally, when you're creating a new page, you select the not in menu section. That keeps it from being displayed on the website until you actually are ready for that. And then you can go through and create and customize your page however you want. Now, we had some questions that came in about how to change some of the menu items and all that stuff, especially the drop-downs and all that, so on. So I'll cover that as well. Side note, one of the awesome things about me getting kicked out of the meeting is I lost all your questions. So my chat window actually starts from scratch. Which is super awesome because I know there's a lot of questions I didn't get to. So if I haven't answered your question, please feel free to submit it again via the chat window and I will do my very best to get to it. But I know that we had some questions about how to reorder some of the things, add things to the menu, and so on. So I want to cover that. So bear with me while we do that. Okay, so let me get to my home page. Now, all of the items that are in my menu, everything that's in here, we have the ability to change and edit those things. Sorry, I'm getting sidetracked reading the questions that are coming in. Twilla asks, can I have all three forms, but just under one tab, not redundant with some subtabs? What you can do, well, actually how things are set up on your template is the forms listing here. If I just click on that, that actually takes me, it's supposed to take you, maybe they changed that. There should be a forms page like this that actually has links to those different forms instead of using that sub tab. The sub tab comes there just to make it a little bit easier so people could find those specific forms right away. So if you don't want to have that, that can be managed within the pages section. So what I'm going to do is I go into my pages section, and everything that's listed on the in the menu here, in the main menu, whether it's a drop down or anything like that, all of that stuff is going to be listed in our pages section. In the pages section, we have the little blue boxes that are called menus, and each menu has a title. You'll see the about menu, contact, forms, main menu, not menu, and some of the other different menus that are applied with your template. Mine has a little bit different ones because I've created menus as I've gone through different webinars and so on and so forth. Now, the main menu section is going to represent everything that is displayed across here. So you see that I have six listings. I have home, about, work with me, recipes, blog, and contact. So in my main menu, I have six tabs, one for each of them. Each one of those tabs is a little bit different. You'll see they have different icons. My home tab has that page icon, so I know that that tab actually goes to the actual home page of the website. Now the about, work with me, recipes, and contact have a different icon. It's hard to see because of the size, but it's a little kind of a family tree type of thing. And you'll notice that for About, Work With Me, Recipes, and Contact, each one of those listings on my website has a drop-down. Just like that. So these icons indicate that tab is for a drop-down. So for example, the About tab shows that this is the About drop-down. Now if I click on this tab, it'll show me some information off to the right. It'll show the name and the menu section. It'll have about menu. What that means is this drop down will show everything that's in the about menu. So this blue box here, that's everything that'll display. So on the home page, when I hover over this, this shows me those three listings, which is those three tabs there. If I wanted it to change to a different one, I can do that down here, and it gives me all the different menus or all the different blue boxes I've created. Okay. Same thing applies when I go to the Work With Me one. I can click on it and I can see that it's linked to the Work With Me menu. So if I scroll down to my Work With Me menu, I see that I have these three options being, these three tabs living in the Work With Me menu. So when I go under here, those are the three options that I have. And one of those options is the Form menu. Okay. Now if I go into my Work With Me menu, I see the Forms tab also has that little family tree type of drop-down icon. So that indicates that this is another drop-down. Now, if I don't want that to be there, I can remove it. I can say, I don't want that to be there. So I'm going to take that tab and I'm going to move it to my not in menu section. Just like that. Now, when I close out of my website or my pages section and refresh, I see that under my Work With Me menu, I don't have that listing anymore. Okay. But let's say I want to link to that forms page that says, that gives me those links to those different forms. Well, we have that page. It's already created for you. And that's the page I showed you earlier that's in the not in menu section. I can take that tab, and remember, it's got the pages icon here. So that's the actual page. So I'm going to drag this, and I'm going to put that back into my Work With Me menu, just like that. And I can reorganize it however I want just by clicking and dragging. Now I'm going to close out of my Pages menu, and I can do that by clicking on the X in the upper right or the Close button, either one. Now the page is going to refresh itself. So now under Work With Me, I have Forms again, but now I don't have that dropdown because it's just linking to my Forms page. So when I click on this page, it'll take me here where a user can click on any specific form page that they want. So that should help answer that question for you, Twilla. Now, we had some other questions. I know Daryl asked how to add different things to our menu system. That's the same process. If I wanted to add a new page to my main menu, like the sales page that I created, I can add my new page, going through the process of adding a new page just like we went through before. If I want to add that as a listing to my main menu, I just need to take that tab and drag it and place it in my new menu section. And then when I close it out, my page will refresh itself and you'll see that listing there. Just like that. Does that kind of answer your question, Daryl, on how to add things to add links and stuff to your main menu? Or did you have a little bit more specific question on that? You don't know how to like add content to the page? Go into edit mode and you'll see all of the different areas that you have. Everything, all these different boxes are all the possibilities of where you can put content. So if you want to add in text, you would go over to the left-hand side and take the text element and drag it and place it wherever you want. And then simply start adding in your text. However you wanted to do it. And then save it. And then it'll be there. And you can always move that stuff around. You can drag it and reorganize it however you want. And so on. You can do the same with images and all that stuff. What I recommend when you're actually creating a brand new page, to not necessarily put it where it's available and accessible for everyone to see, because it's an empty page. You don't have anything on it. It's still in process. You're still working on it. So what you would do is you would put it from your main menu into the not in menu section. And then you can still access it by coming into your pages section and then clicking on the view button for that tab. So then you can go to that page and work on it, but nobody else can see that. So I always recommend that as a good process to kind of to build out the page until you're ready to see it. And then once you're ready for people to see it, then you can simply just move it back into the main menu section or any other section that you wanted to. Sarah asks a great question. How do I link recipe pages to my menu? And I actually have that set up in my menu. What you can do is, if I wanted, I have my, under my recipe section, I have it not to specific recipes, but I have it to specific categories that I've created. So what I did is, in my pages section, in my main menu, you'll see that I have a tab for recipes that has that little family tree drop-down icon. So what I did is I actually set up a drop-down to do that. Before I get started, Daryl has a quick question. What does CSS ID and CSS class mean? When you're creating a page and you have these boxes there, that's for hardcore developer stuff. If you have CSS class and CSS ID, we'll actually do snazzy CSS coding on your website. I don't know how to do anything with it, so it's nothing that is necessarily needs to be there. It's all advanced stuff, so you don't need to worry about that. Once you fill out you create your page, and you should do this for all of your pages, when you click on your page, in the advanced section, you're going to have the SEO title section and the meta description. Those are two important sections that you should fill out for the SEO of your website. If you click on the little question mark, it'll give you a format that how they suggest you fill it out. So for the title, you just want to do the name of the page. So for example, your home page, your business name, and then your location. That's it. You want to do that for every page. And then your meta description is just a text description that's going to talk about that page and what you want people to be able to know from that page. It doesn't have to be super long. You generally should keep it to about 156 characters. But that's generally it. But yes, you should fill those out for all of the pages on your website. All right, so let's get back to Sarah's question about the links to recipes. So what I did is I created a drop-down. So I made my tab, I go to add item, and what you want to do is you want to create a submenu. That's what those tabs are, and you give it a name. The first thing you want to do is you want to create what is called a menu. So you want to create one of these blue boxes. I already have one here for my recipe categories, but if you're going to do something like that, you don't. So I'll create a new one. So I'm going to go to add item, and what I'm going to create is a menu, and that'll give me a new brand new blue box. So I'm just going to call this new recipe menu, and that's all I need to fill out, and then click create. Now I'm going to see I have a brand new blue box that says new recipe menu. So what I want to do inside that box is anything that I want to show up in my dropdown, I want to put in that box. So I want links to different recipes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click Add Item, and I'm going to do a link. So when I click link, I'm going to give it a name in the display name section. Recipe category one. Now I want it to link to something. So what I need to put in here is to actually put in the URL of where I want it to go. Just like when we set up any other link to say, this is where I want it to go. If I want it to go to a specific recipe category, I can click on my recipes tab and I can click on my specific category. So if I want it to go to main course, I can click on that. So now I'm looking at just the recipes in that category. So what I need is my URL for that. And I can find that right up here. And I want to copy all of that information. Everything to the right of the .com. So just that portion there. And I'm going to go ahead and copy that information. Now in this link section here, I'm going to paste that. And now I'm going to create my link. And what I didn't do is I didn't select which menu that I wanted it to go into. When you create a link, menu location is which blue box you want it to go into. I forgot to change that, so it went to my About menu. But I can easily drag it and place it down into the new recipe menu that I wanted, like that. Okay? So now that I have my menu, I can create a drop-down tab to direct to it. So what I would do now is I would go to Add Item and click Create Submenu. And I'm going to select, in the menu section, I'm going to select what I want that drop-down to display. I want it to display my new recipe menu that I made. I can give it a name. And now I want it to say where I want that to go. Which menu do I want it to be in? I want it to be in my main menu so everybody can see it on the website. So that's what I'm going to select. And now when I click Create, you see a new tab right here that says New Recipes, and it has that same icon. I can move this to wherever I want. And now when I close out of my Pages section, you'll see that I have a new recipe section and a listing right below it. When I click on that, it'll take me to that category and how I set up that link. Now, if I wanted that to go to a specific page instead of a link, what I would do is in that same new recipes menu, I could take any page that I have, whether it's my new page or whatever, I can place it. Anything that I want to display in that dropdown, I can add to that menu. And now when my website refreshes, that will show everything that's there. Now the same thing works in reverse is if I want to remove something. If I want to remove something from my main menu, I can simply take that tab and move it to the not in menu section. So if I want to remove my blog section or my events section or so on, I can just drag that tab and move it into the not in menu area. And then when I close out of pages, it'll refresh my page and it'll remove that section for it. Does that kind of help with your question, Daryl? Great. There's also some sections in the support portal. If you scroll down to the managing your website, there's a pages and menu section that actually kind of goes through some of that same stuff. There's some documentations, there's some videos on how to do that. You can even do a search in the search bar for menu, and you'll see how to create a menu and how to create a drop down will be some of the first things that pop up, and there'll be a video walkthrough on how to do some of that same stuff. You are very welcome. It's a question that comes up a lot. Now Sarah asks, why does it show under two separate tabs on your recipe page? It looks a bit silly to have the category with a picture on the side. There's a link that says main course and a link to halibut, for example. Can you have it shown a different layout? Do you mean, can I change the way this looks right here? Is that what you're talking about, Sarah? Are you talking about the main recipe section like this? That's a great question. Sarah's asking why when I click on, when I'm at the main recipe section, which is the main section that everybody has on their templates, why it shows my categories in their little images over here on the left, and then it shows the same information in list format on the right. That's a great question. I don't have an answer for you. That's the way that the recipe section is set up. Unfortunately, there isn't a way to change it. Personally, I think it's a little redundant. I mean, you have the same information in two places to the same information. There isn't a different way to add in a different recipe plugin. That's why I've actually gone through and set up the links. Instead of going to the main recipe section, they can actually just click on the courses or the categories and actually say that. Then if they want to go to a different category from this page, if I click on treats, for example, it'll just show the relevant recipes. So... but as far as changing the way that this looks, unfortunately, there isn't really anything we can do right now. It has been brought up on several occasions on seeing what we can do as far as changing the way that looks and maybe customizing a little bit more. But for right now, we're kind of stuck with that. Tula asks, I created a footer. Can I select with pages I want it on, or is it universal? When you are... on any page of the website and you enter in any content into any of these footer areas, regardless of what template you're on, you'll see that those sections have these little circular icons next to them. If you hover over it, you'll see the word global will come up. What that means is that content, those sections are on every single page of the website. So whatever you put into those content areas will appear on every single page. So for example, this form that I have is on every single page of the website. It's on my contact page, it's on my home page, it's everywhere. So it's the same information. So that footer area is universal. If you want to put something down towards the bottom of the page, you can certainly do that. You'd have to utilize like content area 4 or whatever content section you have towards the bottom of the page. Callie, I don't know if it's a question that you re-asked, but let me scroll up and see. I know that you had some questions that I hadn't got to today, so I want to make sure that. You have a question. I have a question about my expansion bar. For some reason, when a person selects a link and the link expands, they are not able to select the expansion items. My link Work With Me expands to 3 options that a visitor should be able to select: Health Coach, My Approach, and Forms, but the cursor cannot select any of the 3 options. The 3 options close and or disappear. All right, so just to make sure that I'm understanding that question, Callie, so what you're saying is these links, these options show up, but they can't click on them, and they just disappear, right? Okay. Did you change anything with them from what came with your template? Okay. One of the things that we can do is when we go into the pages section... and you were talking about the Work With Me section. That's fine, Sarah. Thank you for joining in today. If anybody has to jump off, feel free. Like I said, the webinar is being recorded, and it'll be posted later I know that there's questions I haven't gotten to. I'm perfectly willing to sit and answer every question that comes in. So if you're willing to be patient, you know, I will get to your questions. I promise you. Okay. So Callie, you're talking about the work with me items here, and they're just not showing. They're not functioning the way they're supposed to. So when we go into the pages section and we check on, the first thing we're going to check is the Work With Me tab in the main menu. So we click on that and it should say which menu it's displaying. So that's the Work With Me menu. So we're going to scroll down to the Work With Me menu, and then we want to make sure that everything, that all the tabs there are the correct type of tabs. Are you still seeing them looking like this, where it's the actual page tabs just like that? They still have the page icons and all that stuff? Thanks for joining in, Joan. Okay. Then there really isn't any reason why they shouldn't be working. They should be just actual links to those specific pages. Are you running into that problem just with the Work With Me tab, or is it the same under all of the other dropdowns and tabs that are in your menu? Because that could be all tabs. There's a bar that is set between some. You have something that's set between your menu and whatnot. Interesting. That is probably going to be something that I'm going to recommend you shoot support a ticket for. Because I'm not sure if it's something with the menu for your website just not working, or if there's something to do with that information. That's weird. What internet browser are you using? Do you know? Google. And it's the Foodie Bonanza template, right? That is interesting. Is it the same template that I'm on right now? Different one? Is it the purple one? Is it this one? This one? Or is it the... Or is it this one? Yeah, you can. If you can give me your URL, I can do that. Scott, you have a question. If I put an image in the background of the heading container, how do you make it responsive? Your website's responsive by default. So wherever you put an image, when your website is condensed to a different smaller screen size, it will be reflective of that. So you don't have to do anything. It does it automatically. Okay, so you have the test one. Yeah, see, I'm not having any issues with it not working. So that's weird. And Isabella, you said you're having the same issue? Yeah, I'm seeing that I can scroll over everything just fine. That's weird. Yeah, I'm not seeing any problems with it. That's odd. For both of you, since you're both having the same problem with the same template, it could be an issue with that particular template. So, what I would recommend for both of you is to submit your support ticket. And try to be as detailed as you can about it in the description. You can even mention that you asked me about it during the webinar and I didn't encounter the same problem. But since both of you are having the same problem on the same template, I think it might be an issue with the template. So I definitely recommend submitting that to the support team so they can take a look at it and see if it's an actual issue with the template that can be resolved. Does that make sense? You are welcome. Thank you for bringing it up. All right, so let's see what else we can get for some of these questions here. Sue asked, we're dropped down, we did that. Marla asked, how do I do email marketing, set up a page, import addresses, send out? The email marketing feature is only available if you've upgraded your site. If you haven't, you won't have the ability to do it. You won't see in your dashboard, you won't see the email marketing tab. So you've upgraded. That's great. So in your pages section, what you should see, Marla, is you should see the email. There should be a tab, or a couple of them maybe. I don't know if I still have them on mine. You should see an email marketing tab like this. When you click on it, it's a blank page. Let me go to a different. I've changed my test site so many times that I don't always have everything that comes with the actual template. So let me pull up one of my newer ones and see. Okay, so in your pages section, you should actually have an email marketing page. So when I click view and go to it, it should look something like this. Do you see the email marketing page in your website, Marla? Okay, so once you get to this page, you'll notice that it looks a little bit different. And this is a good overview for the email marketing for everybody else as well. Your email marketing page is technically a page of your website, but it looks different because it's an email. So you can't send like an actual page. I can't send my home page as an email because there's too much formatting going on with it. If I did send it as an email, most people would never be able to see the images and it wouldn't look the same, just because that's how emails work. Emails are very simplistic. So that's why the email templates are all set up and everybody has one on their website. And it's just very basic. If you go into edit mode, you'll see the different content areas. Excuse me. And it works just like the rest of the website. So you have the ability to add content just like you can anywhere else. You can drag elements in and do all that stuff. You want to keep it very basic. You don't want to do any videos. You don't want to do any really large images. I mean, it's an email, so you want to keep that in mind and make sure that whatever you're sending out is very basic in nature. So you're free to edit your email however you want. When you're ready, you'll see that now, because we're on the email template, there's a little e-blast button right up here. So when I click on that, that'll actually take me to the email section. Okay? So when I have the email section, we have three tabs. The first tab that you should click is email marketing. And what you want to do is you want to fill out this information. You can fill out your from name, so you can put your name and you can put your email address. So that way when somebody gets an email, they can see who it's coming from. And then you fill out your business address. If you don't have a business address, you need to put something, so you can put your personal address or whatever, and then save that. The business address, nobody will see that via the email. It's just something that's required to ensure that the email that you're sending isn't spam. So you want to fill that information out and save it. Once you fill it out once and save it, you are good. Don't have to fill it out again. Next tab we have is our email lists. This is any email list that you've created within your website. This is also found within the dashboard portion of the website in the email marketing tab. There's a list section. This is where you can actually create a brand new list. So I'm going to create a brand new list. and add list. Now I can import a list of contacts that I have. So if I used to use Constant Contact or MailChimp or something like that, I can export that information from that service and import it here. Otherwise, I can go through and I can add in emails one at a time. That's my list section. Now, when I'm actually creating my list, you'll see all of your different lists here. You can also manage them from this section as well. It's the same general area as this. And then the first button is email campaigns. This is where you're actually going to go through the process of creating the email that you're going to send out. You click create new campaign. You fill out your information, give it a name, a subject, and all that information. And then you select your list. Any list that you create will show up here. You just simply click that link, and that's the list it's going to send out to. You'll see this section here that says test email. You want to put your email address there, and you can put anybody else's there as well, and then send yourself a test. And what will happen is you'll actually get an email, a copy of the email that you're sending out. And it's highly recommended that you do this. Actually, it's required that you do it first. That'll give you a chance to see what your email looks like to make sure it looks the way you want it to look and everything before you send it out to potential clients or your customer base or whatever. So then you do that. Once you send out the test, then this button will actually change to go ahead and send out the campaign. Once you sent out the campaign, in your dashboard section, you'll be able to see the different statistics and stuff that you have, how many opens and so on that you have with those specific campaigns. That's essentially the email marketing portion. It's very basic, very straightforward, and so on. Noah asked a couple great questions. Can I integrate MailChimp with this? You can integrate MailChimp in the sense that you can have a form placed on your website where they could sign up to be added to your MailChimp list. You could also utilize the feature that I talked about where you could export your information from MailChimp and then import it within your website. So you could do that. Now you also ask, can we schedule it or does it have to be sent immediately? There isn't the ability to schedule an email. So you are not going to be able to create an email campaign to send out next Friday. It doesn't work that way. So whatever you want to schedule and do, you would have to do it and send it out right away. So if I wanted to send out an email starting next Friday, I would have to set up my campaign and send it out next Friday. Does that make sense? Perfect. Adriana asked how to add the free document in the homepage when people sign up. Noah asked, will you add the scheduling feature? That I don't know. I know that our development team would like to make some changes to the email marketing service that we have. I don't know what specifically they're thinking about doing, and I don't have a time frame for when it would be done. So, Adriana asked, how to add the free document on homepage when people sign up? I'm presuming you're referring to the lead generation form on the homepage. Is that correct? Because this form that comes with every website is using the IIN form element and it's using the IIN lead generation form, the giveaway for the free cleanse cheat sheet is all that's available. You can set that up by going into your dashboard, clicking on the IIN form element, and selecting the lead generation form. Here are the settings for your lead generation form. In the email response to section, you want to put your email address. So that way, anytime somebody fills out that form, you get an email notification saying that they filled out that form. Now, the download portion here, this is where you can select which cheat sheet you want to give away with that form. You select that, then this information, the above download button, is just a general welcome information email or information that you want to say to people when they fill out the form. So they would fill out that form, click sign me up. They'd be redirected to this portion where it'll say this and it'll give them the option to download that PDF. And then all the information that's gathered by that form will be viewed down here towards the bottom. I don't have any information because nobody's ever filled out this form on my site, so nothing is listed here. So that's that information in kind of in a nutshell. There's also some more in-depth documentation in the support portal about that. Now, if you want to do a giveaway for something else, and you don't want to use those cheat sheets, you do have the ability to create your own. It's a little bit more labor intensive. It's not as simple as just using the IIN form element. You'd actually have to create your own form and process to do that, but it's certainly possible. In the support section, in the form section under the IIN apps, we have a little bit more information on how to utilize the IIN form application, but there's also a video that walks through how to create your own lead generation, so your own giveaway, if you don't want to use the cheat sheet. So I recommend checking those aspects out. Now, Marla also asks, as far as the email marketing, how do we get people to sign up? If you want people to sign up for your email marketing or to receive a newsletter or so on, you can actually go through, just like we have on the contact page that comes with the template, you can actually create a form yourself. So on the contact page, we have this form that's already there. And all of that information that's gathered by this form, so we have first name, last name, email, phone number, you can do the same thing. You can create your own form for a newsletter sign up. You can do that by creating a form. You can use the form element. And you can place this anywhere on the page, on any page of the site. And just select what you want people to gather. If you want it to be their name, if you want their email address, and so on, you can have that set up. And then all of that information is actually stored within your dashboard. In the dashboard section, there is a form section where you can click on that, and it'll show all the forms you've created in your website. And if you click on the view data section, it'll show actually all the information that's been gathered by that form. And you can always export that information and have that added to your email marketing. So whether you have email marketing that you're using within the website, or if you have email marketing that you're using somewhere else, you can always have that information gathered on your website and then export it somewhere else, or export it to you somewhere else. Does that kind of make sense, Marla? And you can also find more information on the form port, on how to build forms and so on, within the video tutorial section. There's actually a video on actually how to create a form. Or you can actually do a search for form. And the first thing that'll pop up is how to create a form. So there's that ability too. All right, let's see what some of the other questions that I haven't gotten to yet. Twilla asks, is there a footer that isn't global? No. The footer is global, and it always will be. All right, so let's see what else we missed. I appreciate everybody's patience while I get through the different questions. Like I said, I will do my very best to make sure that I can answer each and every one of them. So, we got a question. How do you add images to recipe categories? When you actually are in your recipe section and you are creating your categories in the category tab, you have the ability to add in an image. You need to actually take that image from your file manager in order to do that. It's not a difficult process. There are a few steps involved. But in the support portal under the recipe section, there's a new recipe video that walks through it. Also, you can click on the Create Categories guide, and it walks you through how to do that. there's actually a section on how to add an image. And the video actually will walk you through the process of how to get the URL and all of that stuff, as does this portion as well. So I recommend checking that information out. That should help you do what you're asking to do. Noah asks, if I add www before my domain, it takes me to a dead-end IIN site. Is there a way to fix that? Noah, have you gone through the process of setting your website live already? Okay. When you went through and set it live, I presume you went into your dashboard and your account information and went through the manage your alias section. Is that correct? Okay. When you do that, you want to make sure that you're adding in both the non-www.version and the www.version of your URL. Once you do that, within your DNS provider, you want to make sure that you've gone through the process of launching for both of them. That's outlined in our support section. There's actually a brand new section that I created not that long ago about how to set your site live and what you need to do with it. So if you're having problems with the www.version not working, check out this section, especially the going live process. Make sure that you've covered all those steps for both versions, and if you haven't, that's probably what your issue is. So I definitely recommend checking that out. If you're still running into problems, go ahead and shoot support a ticket information, and they'll should be able to help you. But I'm pretty sure that once you go through that guide, you'll be able to figure out what the issue is. So, Anne asks, how do you reduce the size of your logo on top of the homepage? Once you've updated your logo, if you go into edit mode and you click on your actual logo section in the default, when you click on it, I don't have a logo selected right now. When you click on a logo, you'll be able to see this size section here where you can select a different size. Otherwise, you can also go to where it says create custom size. And if you just enter in a width, it'll automatically create a new size listing to compensate for that. So if your logo is too small, too big, you can click on it and you can kind of adjust the way that it looks. Keep in mind that you never want to select a size that's bigger than the original size of your logo. And your original size will always be the last listing. So for this picture, it's list 758 by 758. That's the actual original size of that picture. So I just want to make sure that I never go any bigger than that. But that's how you should be able to change that. You are welcome, man. All right, so let's see what else we got here. Twilla asked a question that I just lost. Let me see what we got here. On the homepage, there's a sign-up offer to receive an article. I did a test sign-up, and I did not receive anything. Do we have to link it to somehow? If I create my own offer, how do I link it to the sign-up box? That goes through with what I kind of covered a little bit ago about the form section. To create your own custom giveaway, if you don't want to use that, definitely check out the video on how to do it. It'll walk you through start to finish how to create your own. Now, with the one that came with the website, what happens is the first thing that you need to do is you should go into your dashboard and click on the form section of the form application and click on the lead generation form and set up your settings. So you want to make sure that you have it set up to either open in a light box or redirect to a new page. That way, when someone fills out the form and they put in their email address, when it clicks sign me up, whatever you have set up will happen. If you have it set up to a light box, this is a light box. It's a little window that pops out, and it'll have a link that they can click on to download that cheat sheet. If you have it set up to redirect to a new page, it'll redirect to a part of the website where it'll say the exact same information and give you that same link to download that PDF. That's where you're going to get it. You're not going to they're not going to receive it via email or anything like that. All right, sorry about that, everyone. Normally, I don't get kicked off more than once in a webinar, but today apparently is my lucky day. I'm sorry about the delay with that. Did that help answer the question with the form as far as what happens with that? You should, whenever somebody fills it out, if you're using the lead generation form, they'll have that link to the download button to be able to get that form. So you want to make sure that you have your settings set up in your dashboard for that. So when you click on the sign me up button, it says junk folder. Really? That's weird. Do you have your settings set up in the form portion of the dashboard? Everything is set up here. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. I've never heard of that issue. If for whatever reason, Twilla, that's still not working, everything is set up the way that it's supposed to be, everything looks correct, then you can go through and you can submit a support ticket to it. Or like I said, if you wanted to use something other than the cleanse cheat sheet PDF, if you wanted to do your own, you can certainly go through that process and create your own form. I know a lot of people don't necessarily want to use the cleanse cheat sheet, so they've done that aspect of it. So hopefully that'll help. Twyla, thank you for correcting me. Just like what happened earlier, I lost all your questions again. So if I haven't gotten to your question, I do sincerely apologize. Please feel free to shoot it out again. Like I said, I'm in no hurry, so I will do my very best about adding in or answering all questions that we have. Mona asked, I'd like to add an image in a content area. I want the text flush left and the image to the right of that text. I've tried importing the image through the edit area, but it is not allowing me to have the text and image next to each other. That is an excellent question, Mona. You actually have the ability within a text tool to add in an image. Now, what Mona's trying to do is she has text just like there's text here, and she wants to have an image next to it. So the image is off to the left, or to the image is off to the right, and the text is on the left. If you try to place an image where there's already text, it won't let you. You only have the ability to add it above or below. But if we actually go into our text area like this, we have the ability, we can either do it here, or we can go under our insert menu and we can insert an image this way. This is a nice little option. So Mona, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to insert an image, and this process is going to be the same for you to do the same thing. So there's also a video in the support forum, in the support portal, under, if we go image, there is a video that walks through that same process of inserting an image with the text element. So it's going to cover this same thing that I'm going to cover now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to insert an image, and I'm going to place my text on the left and the image on the right, just like you're asking. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to click my mouse right at the beginning of this text. You can see it's highlighted right there, and I can click it anywhere, but I'm going to just do the beginning of the text. So now I'm going to go to my Insert Edit Image button and click that. It's going to open up this window, and what I want to do is I want to click on the source folder here. That's going to take me to my file manager where I can select whatever image I want to place. I'm just going to select this little bench picture here. So I click on it. You'll see a little thumbnail of your picture here. Over here on the right-hand side is the important portion. This is the size of the picture. By default, it's always going to list the original size. So I can see that this is a very, 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 very large picture. I don't want it to be that large because it's just going to go in my text area. So I want to click on this little notepad icon here. And I have the ability to enter in a custom size, or I can select some of these predetermined ones. Now, I don't really know how big I want my image right now. So generally what I do is I select something that's already listed here. The medium-sized thumbnail is a good place to start. So I'm going to go ahead and click that. And I can see my size has been adjusted, and I can click Accept. I don't need to worry about anything else. I can put a description here if I'd like to. Otherwise, I don't need to do anything else, and I can click OK. Now you see that my image is there. But it's not looking very well with the text. It's just sitting there. So what I want to do now is I want to set up the parameters for my picture. So what I want to do now is click on my picture, and you said you wanted your text on the left and the image on the right. So once I have my picture selected, I want to click the alignment right up here, just like that. And now I have my text over here on the left and my image on the right. Now you said you wanted the text to be flush left, which it is, and the image to be flush right, which it is. But now you can also see that my text actually goes right up to the side of that picture, which doesn't necessarily look the greatest. So also what I can do is I can click on my picture, and if I go back to the Insert Edit Image button, now this time, if I click on the Advanced tab, what I have here is I have three boxes that say vertical space, border, and horizontal space. Really, either one is fine. You can use any one of them. I always just do the vertical space because the vertical refers to the left and right side of that image, where the horizontal is the top and the bottom. But generally, whatever you enter in, it's going to apply to the entire thing. So that's why it doesn't really matter. What you want to put here is a number. And the number that they're looking for is the pixel space that you're going to surround the image with. So basically, you're going to create a border. What I generally start with is something like 5. 5 pixels is not very big, but it's enough to keep a nice space. So I'm going to enter in my pixel width and click OK, and you'll see this little space kind of start there. Now I can also adjust that if I want to, and say I don't want that, I want it to be 8, and I can do that here as well. Now I click that and click OK, and now you see that that space is taking effect around my image, so I can't add any more text next to that picture. It kind of made that little buffer. So you can do that. And now I can adjust that even further if I want to. Like I said, it generally doesn't, whatever you enter in for the horizontal generally applies to the vertical as well. So then you can go ahead and save your changes. And you can continue to add text, but that'll give you that same look that you're looking for. And if you wanted to switch it up so your text is on the left or the right instead of the left, click on the image, and instead of align right, you can undo that and select left, and it'll do that very same thing. You could even do centered if you wanted to, but for the most part, that doesn't really make much of a difference. Does that make sense to you, Mona? With a list, it might be a little bit more difficult. The lists generally are kind of a pain that way. So I don't know if you're having problems with it not working with the list. Sometimes it's going to be a little bit cumbersome. I've honestly never tried it with a list, so I don't know how that would work. What I would recommend is if you're trying to try it with a list would be to create your first item in the list, and then so for example, if I was going to create a list, if this is my first item, I would try placing the image before I make the second item and then trying it that way, and maybe even placing the image at the beginning of the first item list and doing it that way. But that's a great question. I've never tried it that way. Arlene asks, how do I change the font size and color on my recipe section on the website? The color that's set on the website is not visible to someone who is colorblind. What you would want to do is the colors and everything that's available and the look of how things look on the recipe section is all dictated within the design section and the colors portion of the website. So what I recommend is on your website, go to your recipe section. And if it helps, you can even open it in an additional tab. But you want to go into your recipe section. And then on a separate tab, and that's why I recommend the separate tab, go into your design section and adjust some of the colors. I'm not sure exactly what we have set up with that. I want to say the default color for links is what's going to set this stuff up. So right here, if I set this to be blue, and I save that change. Now when I refresh my page, all of my tabs are, all my links are blue. Okay? Now I also have a hover color that's also set to pink so that I can change that right here. So that's how you can change the text of the wording or the color of the wording. As far as the text goes, that's where you get into the typography section where you start adjusting the main text of your website and your different headings and so on. So adjusting that will change the way that the text looks. But as far as the color, that's going to be done in the color section by adjusting the color of your links. Now keep in mind, when you do that, it's actually going to adjust the color of the links throughout the entire website. So it's not just that particular page, it's the entire website. So now you see all of my links now are blue instead of the pink. So I hope that answers that question for you, Arlene. Sue asks, can I copy and paste text from another template onto my site? Text, yes. You can copy and paste text from anywhere onto your website. One of the things you want to keep in mind is if you're copying text from a different website or a Word document or anything like that, it's not necessarily going to look the same. So let me show you what I mean. So in this tab, I have open to this website, which is this template. And let me go to a blank page. And in another tab, I'm going to open up a different website. So let's open up my other template, which is this one. Now I can just copy this text like this, and I can copy. And on my website, I can go into edit mode and I can bring in a text area. And I can click on it. And I can't right click and paste, but I can go up and do my command shortcut and paste in the text. Now, by default, what's going to happen is if I undo this. This button right here is always checked by default, and that button says paste as text. So when I paste in the stuff that I copied, it's basic, it's plain. It doesn't look the same way that it looks from where I'm copying it from. Now I can go through and I can uncheck that box and then paste in my content. And it's going to look as much as possible like where I'm copying it from. My downfall of that is it's not going to look the same because everything that wherever I'm copying it from, whether it be another website or a Word document or wherever, it has what's called formatting on it that gives it the look. So it has formatting that makes it this font, it makes it that size, it makes this text bigger and bold and all that stuff. And when I copy and paste that from wherever onto my website, sometimes that formatting doesn't really agree very well with your website. So you might run into issues with that. What I recommend is when you're copying and pasting from someplace, you go ahead and you paste it as text, just like it's set by default. Then once you paste it in, then you can go through and you can adjust it however you want. If I want to make this text bold and I want it to make it super huge, I can do that very easily, and it's not going to mess anything up. So that's how I recommend doing that. Does that make sense, Sue? Now, Twyla asked, if we've chosen one template but want to see what our content looks like in another one, is that possible without losing the first one? Yes. You have the ability to change your template if you'd like. I generally don't recommend it, but you certainly can. If you're going to change your template, I recommend you try it doing it before you start any editing whatsoever. The reason for that is every template is set up different. They have different content areas. They don't all have the same content in areas. So if I have this template, for example, and it's missing certain content areas, some of that content might not transfer if I change templates. And I'll show you an example. So this is what my homepage looks like on this Foodie Bonanza template. Now, if I want to change to the Zest template, for example, I can go under the Design tab, and I can click on the Design Gallery, and I can click on Zest, and I can click either Add to My Designs or Apply Selected Design. I'm going to go ahead and apply selected design. You'll see this confirmation message, and I can close that, and my website's going to refresh. Now, this has come up a lot, and I want to address this so everybody is aware of this. You'll see that I've changed my template, but my homepage looks exactly the same. And the reason for that is if I go back to my design tab, I can see that the current design is set for Zest, but nothing's changed. So what I need to do is I need to now go into page template, and I can see that nothing has been selected here. So I need to make sure this is my homepage, so I want to select the homepage template. And then I click apply selected template. And now it'll refresh. And now my page has gone and changed to the same format as the Zest template. But now you see it looks different. It doesn't look the same as my old website. The content's in different areas. The background images are gone. Some of the different things are, it looks different. It's because it's a completely different website. So it's going to change the way that things look, and not necessarily in a good way. So you can see what it looks like, but then you're kind of going to have to go through and re-edit your website. So you kind of have to start from scratch a little bit to do that. The same thing will happen on all the other pages. They're going to look a little bit different than they did on the previous website. So now, that's a great question, Twyla. Now she's asking, how do you go back to the original? What you would do is go back to the Design tab, and now click on My Designs, and you'll see the designs that you have, and select your original one, and click Apply Selected Design. And then I can close out of that, and the website will refresh. Your inside pages will go back to what they were. Now, if I click back on my home page, it's going to still look like the Zest template. And I have to do that very same thing. Go back to Design, select Page Template, select Home Page, and Apply. And then it'll go back to the way it was. But like I said, if you want to do that, I do recommend doing it from the get-go before you start editing a lot of your stuff. You can always go back and change it, but if you want to change from one template to another, just keep in mind, you're going to have to put some work into it to make it look good. So hopefully that all makes sense for everyone. All right. If there are any questions that I haven't gotten to, I know that there was a lot of questions that came in earlier. I know that I didn't get to a lot of them. So if there's anything else that I haven't gotten to that, you know, you want to go over, by all means, ask away. I'm more than happy to take the time to answer it. So please feel free to shoot that out. Otherwise, like I said, the Facebook group is an excellent resource to use. The support portal is an excellent resource to use. Sue asks, quick question about incorporating another site. Do I create a pads and tab? I'm not sure what you mean by pads. A page and tab? Well, depends on how you want to do it. If you just want to link to another site, you can do what we covered earlier, where in your pages section, you can create a link. So let's say I wanted to create a link that goes to another business that I have or another website that I have. In the link portion, you just paste in that complete URL. So for example, let's say I want to link it to my other website. I want to link it to this one. Completely separate website. So I'm going to copy that entire URL. And that's what I want to paste in my link section. And then I just give my listing a name. And just like before, I select where I want it to go. So I want it to be in my main menu. And then I click Create Link. Now in my main menu section, I'll see the tab for it. And I can rearrange it to whatever order I want, but I'll leave it at the end for right now. Exit out of Pages and the website will refresh. And now I have that listing. So now when I click on it, what it'll do is it'll take me to that second website. One of the things that you want to make sure that you're doing that I didn't do is when you create that link, especially if it's going to a different website, what you want to do for that link is there's an option right here that says open a new window. You want to make sure to select that and then click update. That way, whenever someone clicks on that link, it will open a new window, taking them to that link and still leaving a window back to your website. So you don't want to drive people away from your website. You want to bring them back to your website or keep them at your website. So can you mask the URL? No, there really isn't, because when you create that link, you have to put that link in there. So whenever they click on it, it's going to show that URL that they have. So you won't be able to mask it at all. Any other questions? Anything that you want me to cover again? Anything that I didn't quite explain clear enough the first time? I know it's been a longer webinar today, but like I said, I'm perfectly content answering questions. So, but I understand that I don't want to take up a lot of everybody's time. So if there's no questions and people have to jump off, that's perfectly fine too. We do this every week. Just want to let everybody know now, and I'll mention it next week as well. We will not be having a webinar the week of Thanksgiving due to the holiday and the short week. I think it'll just be easier to not do one that week. So people don't have to shuffle their schedules and so on. So just an FYI heads up for now. So, but again, if there's any other questions, feel free to ask away. Otherwise, like I said, utilize the support portal. Always trying to build that out and make it better for you all. So if there's things that you're seeing that aren't very helpful, if some of the guides just don't answer your questions, by all means, let us know. Let me know. You can let me know via webinar. You can, if you've joined into the Facebook group, you can let me know that way. I'm always trying to make these resources better and more helpful for you, so everything can make sense and help you build out your websites. So by all means, let me know. Like I said, the video for today's webinar will be posted on the support portal within 24 hours or so. It'll always be the first listing that's shown there. And again, the Facebook page, that's always something that is a good resource. Let me go ahead and post in that URL one more time for everybody. It's a good resource to use. Like I said, I try to answer questions as much as possible. So that's a great resource as well. So lots of great questions today. Good participation. We had a lot of people this week, so that's always great to see. I know we had a question last week, so where somebody asked how long we'll be doing this. I will continue to do this as long as there are people willing to participate and ask questions. So I don't have any plans to stop doing these. if we start getting an increased amount of people that are trying to join in and all that stuff, we can even look into the possibility of doing it more than once a week. I'm not opposed to doing this twice a week if we have to. So there's always that option. So, but like I said, if we don't have any other questions, I think we can start kind of wrapping it up. So if you have any last minute questions or anything like that, by all means, feel free to let me know. Otherwise, I think we can start winding it down. But again, thank you for your questions, your participation, and your patience. I'm actively trying to figure out why I keep getting kicked out of the meetings. I know it's an inconvenience for you, but it's also an inconvenience for me, so hopefully I can get that issue resolved. But you are very welcome. I enjoy helping and doing these webinars every week, so I'm glad that you're all finding it useful and enjoyable as well. But if there's no other questions, I think we'll go ahead and we'll call it a day. Like I said, within 24 hours, the video will be posted on there. Definitely check out some of the other webinars. We've covered a lot of good questions in the last couple of them. So we'll continue to do so. So for those of you that were joining in for the first time, I hope you enjoyed it and found it useful. For those of you that have joined in before and came back, thank you. And I hope to see you guys again next week. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of your day.